So welcome today to the Diversity Circle session with our guest Andrew Judge. He's here to speak on the culture of mentoring. So we're very honored to be here today with our guest. My name is Derek Kamel Joseph. I'm a member of Clausden Nation, which is a Dakel community in northern British Columbia. I'm of mixed ancestry, so I'm also of Irish descent. And you might hear Irish referred to a few times today. I'm an advisor with the Aboriginal Services Department and also an FSA Director at Large, and honored to be part of the Diversity Circles with Kyla Epstein and Shannon Kelly. Remember your last name. Yeah. So I would like to first recognize the unceded traditional Coast Salish territories that BCIT's main campuses are located. And I would like to call up our elder from Aboriginal Services, Elf Dumont, to do a welcoming.
Alfred Dumont, Indigenikaz, Bidabin Migizi, Anishinaabe Niwints, Obisheshki Ndodum, Shanaga Ndujniba, Kokwetlam Nida. I hold in my left hand a small bit of tobacco. We give thanks each day for the gifts that we have been given by the Creator. We say, Migwech Nimishomas, Migwech Nokomas, Migwech Chemanado. We give thanks for the gifts that we are given, the food that you're eating. We give thanks for that because we recognize that all of that comes from the territory where we are walking and standing and live each day. These gifts of food give us the strength inside to walk. But there are many other gifts that we are given. So we always give thanks to the Creator for the water, for the earth, for all our two-legged and four-legged and multi-legged beings, for the fish that swim in the water, and for those that fly high above us. We give thanks for those are all our relations. We are but part of a circle, and a small part. Although we forget and we think we are the most important, we are just a small part of the circle. And we have to walk with that kind of humility and understanding when we walk in the world. So we give thanks. We say to the Creator, we thank you for the Eastern Door and the teachings of the Eastern Door. We give you thanks for the Southern Door, door of relationships. We give you thanks to the Western Door, the door to spirit world. We give you thanks to the Northern Door for the elders and what they carry, all those messages, all those stories that they have to tell us. And we ask for the wisdom to be able to listen quietly, as the elders speak, as the elders share their stories. And there are many elders in our community. So we give thanks for those. And we give thanks to Mother Earth for all that Mother Earth provides for us, everything we need. And we seek to walk carefully on the earth. And we seek to relate to the earth because we would not have what we have if it not been that the earth provides those things. So we have to be careful how we relate to the earth. And that's quite true for us at BCIT because we are into industry as well. So we have to be careful of how industry relates to the earth because we want to provide for our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren and beyond that the same what was given to us. We have that responsibility. We have to learn from that circle of life how to be in the circle of life. So when you're sharing at your tables today, listen carefully to what your neighbor says. Listen to their story, because each of us has a story, very much as Zah said. We come, many of us, from mixed ancestry. And Zah and I are connected because we have Irish descent, not only because we have First Nations descent. We are related. We are related in ways that we do not know. And that's why we have to listen carefully to the story. But I also want you to listen to one of the great groups of people that or beings that gather here, the Andegs, the Crows. They are a big nation around here. And we have to listen to their voices. Care for them in the way that they often care for us, but we don't know. Care for the eagles that fly high. Listen to them when they speak, because they're telling us something. That's part of our relation. And even listen to Anamush, little dog, because dog has something to say too. And coyote, coyuria, always has something to say. We listen and we relate. So listen to your brothers and sisters as they speak. Listen carefully, and you will learn something about yourself. When we were sharing the other day in the group, it's interesting when you hear the story that someone very familiar to you shares, they'll share it in a different way each time. That's because the Spirit is speaking through them. We are a spiritual people. We want to acknowledge that Spirit in everything we do. So in a scientific place, we need to recognize that there's more to life than just what we think in terms of science. We think beyond that into the great mystery of life. And that is part of the circle of which we are part. So welcome to this day. Share carefully. Share in humility. But hear each other. We say miigwech, 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 miigwech. Aho.
Elf, the thank you handshake, which is thank you very much for your time. And please stick around before this Wander speaks at the start. Yeah, the diversity circles is really built on the awareness of three circles, so gender, indigenous, learning differences, and neurodiversity, and the discussion that we can have within each, and the dialogue that comes from that awareness. So I'll just ask Shannon to say a couple words here before we do get Andrew up here.
Thank you, Zahn. Thank you, Alf. Thank you everyone for coming. I know it's a long weekend, so your commitment to staying on this campus is much appreciated. Some of you have attended several Diversity Circles events, and for some it might be one of your first times. So I don't want to spend too much time talking about Diversity Circles in detail, because on your table you have a great document, which is a newsletter all about Diversity Circles. So I'll draw your attention to that newsletter, and we do have extra copies at the side here, but it's a great resource to take back to your department, to take back to your programs if you want to learn more about. We talk specifically about what is Diversity Circles, why Diversity Circles, how it works. We talk in detail about the Indigenous framework, an Indigenous framework that we're using. But our guest speaker, Andrew, is going to go into detail about all this, so I won't say much more than that. The only other thing I want to mention today, as well as just thanking you for coming, is just that Diversity Circles is built on collaboration and partnership. So we've run many different events. We had an event last week, which was a partnership with the communication department and others. Last year, we ran events in partnership with the Learning and Teaching Center and the DRC. So it's really about partnering with communities at BCIT and other groups at BCIT. We're happy to partner and to work with you. So if you have suggestions about events or facets of diversity that you want to work with us on, we really want to hear from you. I also want to acknowledge the contribution that Aboriginal Services has made in terms of what they have given to this institution, coming up on their 25th anniversary fairly soon, I think, in the next couple of years. And Aboriginal Services has really provided so much to this community as far as teaching and helping us all to reach into new areas of knowledge. So I want to acknowledge that. Joanne Stone Campbell, the coordinator, the other staff, including Za, Celeste, elders such as Alf and Mary Roberts, as well as Corey Wilson, the VP of Indigenous Partnerships and Education. So just wanted to mention and acknowledge Aboriginal Services as well here on the campus. And with that, I'll hand the mic back to Za to introduce our guest speaker and say a few more words too. Oh, no, I'm wrong. I always, you know, get something wrong, but that's okay. It's because I'm speaking extemporaneously without notes. Or maybe I'm just not prepared. I'm going to hand the mic to Kyla, and she will tell us a bit more before we introduce Andrew.
Thank you, Shannon. Okay, so just a few sort of housekeeping event-related things. First and foremost, please eat and eat lots. It's there for you. If you haven't had a chance to do a name tag, they're on your tables. It really helps when you start to talk with each other a little bit to have names on there. I encourage you to put anything you'd like on there, your preferred name, how your name is pronounced if you feel like people need that, anything that you want to share there. There, a part of Diversity Circles is collecting your voices in many different ways, and so we've got some ways for you to do that today. There's a small white paper that has a question on there just for some silent reflection, internal thoughts to share with us. Our amazing operations assistant figured out how to print on Post-it notes, so if you can complete the sentence on the Post-it note and then put it on one of the flip chart papers as you leave, that would be great. This larger sheet and the markers associated, the color markers there, are for you to just capture any of your thoughts related to this. Instead of a standard evaluation form at the end, we prefer to have you share with us any lessons you learned, any commitments you've made, how you felt during the session, so if you can do that there. And then related to our funding responsibilities and how many workshops and for how many people, we really need you to sign in so we can do some quantitative data there. So that's a lot, but it's all on your table as a reminder there. And of course, the notepads and pens are there for you to use and to take away as well. I think that covers it. And so, thank you.
Thanks, Kyla. So as was mentioned before, there's the intersections between the circles are important, and indigenous people have intersections and relations all over the world. So I'm actually quite honored to have my cousin actually on campus today, and that's Simon John. He's the counselor for my nation up north. And in introducing Andrew, whose spirit name is Bear Walker from the Turtle Clan, him and I always talk back and forth, and this is part of mentorship, or part of the gifts we actually receive and are joined together. Him and I go back and forth quite a bit and find similarities and things that we connect on. But with Simon here, I thought that it would be good for him to come up and talk a little bit about how Klazdan Nation and the Dakel community up north, the relations to Sus, which is Bear up there. So I'm going to ask Simon to come up for a few minutes. Howdy.
Howdy. Merci, Derek. A detu masi no ra tas ni sin jan no so ne nas jan ke ne gani be no pasiati sta kanit dan za upa nas te ha ke dan da tin le Henry C. Joseph zita in live khazli ke en upa apat ni Camel Joseph 100 years on anu ye pe yaskar hon le in le 1800, late 1800, it was lit in Lenke. 2003, it does say. And then we had a stuck on it, ne tone, these zakne nezada, ne pasha stuck in the azatne, the nezatne, keoha dachane. And ever runny bear, hold the lehinle, yep. And then, I was like, Sas khayat til taketam. Astam davatanam apa utis pasyas takke. Sas khayat takke that ni icha dene inle ata. Ata wat cho ita dene inle sas. I want to speak about what I said earlier. First, I'd like to say thanks to the Coast Salish people here for allowing me to speak here. My cousin Zah's dad is from where I'm from. It's called Zitain Lee, and that's Middle River in English. It's according to history, it's one of the oldest communities in central BC. His dad is named Henry Joseph, and Henry named him Zah, and I guess he read those things there, and he didn't like that name. So he changed it to Derek, which is his middle name. But he found out why his dad called him Zah, so he changed it back, which is good. Over the years, I got to know him, and I have been in contact with him all the time about things that are going on at home. And I like the way that man opened up of how we're connected to the land, everything, water, salmon, I talked about it, crows, and to us it's crows, not ravens, but still the same thing, eagles. Our ancestors tell us that, you know, you have to have respect for animals because they were humans before us, according to our ancestors, like the bear was a man. And, you know, even I had experiences with crows coming to me and gawking at me. And a lot of other people would not realize what was going on. But after I asked my grandfather what it meant, if you're hunting, it means good luck. You're going to see bear. You're going to see blood from an animal which is going to provide you for food and all that. But if it came to you in a village or a house and started gawking at you, he's giving you bad news. The connection to all the animals, not only crows, we said, but grouse is one of the very strong animals that gives messages. When I was talking about sus bear earlier, I had an experience way up in the mountains, and I used to go up there with my uncle Walter. They call him Mountain Man, because he just loved it up there. So one night went to bed after we went to camp, we had a lean-to, and I could hear this bear coming. He was crunching and dry needles. You can hear that when you're out camping. And it came around the lean-to, and it was there face-to-face with me. And I kept calling my uncle, and he wouldn't wake up. Because you're in a state where it's so real. It's called it's not a dream, but it's a vision. He came right into my sleeping bag, and at first I was scared, and then I realized I can't go nowhere. He's already here. So I just let it happen. And it curled right up with me, right beside me in my sleeping bag, and I let it go. The thing I realized that same night, I heard it coming, and then when it went around, I didn't hear him going. I didn't know about that till I got home, which is like a day's walk back to the camp. And I asked my grandfather about it. And he said, "Good, I went and that did knee went." He said, "He has released you. you are allowed to go to where he works and where he lives. That's what happened to me. And I was too young and naive to know exactly what happened till I asked him. And he said, now you're allowed to roam in the bush the same place he does. So, you know, that's the connection between all things on earth. Like he said, you know, the proper way for us is to give thanks every day, for everything. You know, that's I talked about a bit about our Azatne and elders. They're the ones that, you know, mentor us. You know, like you said, you stay quiet when there's somebody talking. You weren't allowed to talk or anything until you were asked to. And then, you know, my dad was a very wise person. I don't know, a lot of you know Ed John here. He's a grand chief, lawyer. His mentor was my dad, Pierre John Gamel Joseph, his grandpa. So, you know, it's my dad's gone now 5 years, so, I mean, that's where you learn it from your ancestors here. I guess it's professors and, you know, for us it's different, you know, but it's all connected and it's very powerful, I know that. So remember your dreams and someday you'll be in it, you never know. Merci.
So I know Andrew remembers his dreams, so please come share.
Okay, thanks. Just make sure this is on. Thanks, man. Bonjour, hi everybody. I'm gonna spend some of my time over here behind this desk. But most of my time, I'm going to try to be engaging. And can we just give a little bit of a round of applause for the people who organized today? Spending the last 3 days here has been really rewarding just to see the dedication that this team has given to this project and the celebration of diversity. So. I'm going to give thanks to the Coast Salish peoples, the people whose ancestors lived here, who left their footprints here, and who honored this place. And so I'm a visitor here, and the first thing we do as visitors is we honor the original ancestors of this place. So they're pretty incredible people. I think we've all noticed that. And yeah, I'm a little nervous, but I'll get through it. So I'm going to get my pointer. Here it is. Okay. So that last slide, that picture, that was from the last time I was here. I think some of you remember that. Who was here last time? Okay, a few of you. Good. So it's great to see new faces. And I'll start with my introduction in my language, so bonjour. Mko Mose indigenous, Mexican do them. Teshkanzi bi indunjba, Anishinaabe in any endow, Ojibigi in any endow, and we shall ganashi. So I'll speak English again, and my spirit name, as Derek mentioned, is Bear Walker. My English name is Andrew. I have ancestry in the North Shore of Lake Huron, as well as in Northern Ireland. So I've been visited by my ancestors of the Northern Ireland, and wow. Who has Irish ancestry in here? Yeah, okay. We come from a pretty incredible peoples. And I don't know if you know about Irish and the gold that they had, but if I go too far off topic, I'll never get finished. So I've been working in the area of Indigenous education for about 10 years now. And started out with working at a camp as a camp counselor, and then I began designing, facilitating, and hosting Indigenous youth mentoring programs for high school and elementary students. That was an incredible experience. That's when I dedicated my life to serving Indigenous people, and that's when the dreams really started. Dreamt I had long hair at that time and haven't cut it since. So after that time, I've had this extraordinary journey where I've been able to deliver Indigenous programming at the post-secondary level, not only designing, facilitating, and teaching, but you know, working with community members. It's a community-based program, and we always went to the community first. We went to the elders, we brought tobacco, we brought medicines, and we said, you know, what do you guys think, and how should this look? And so that's part of the reason why I'm here today. I'm gonna get feedback from you guys. It's gonna hopefully be engaging once I get in my flow, you know, coming up here, but that's okay. I love to speak, I love to share, and I can't wait to learn from you guys today. Before I do that, I just want to talk about the power of the exchange of the gift. Okay, so I'm coming here today to ask you guys to share your gifts, and I'm going to share a little bit of mine. We have like an hour together, so it's not too much time, but a gift can be so powerful. How many people here have received a gift within the last month? How many people remember what it is? Yeah. Who forgets what they're getting? You don't forget a gift, right? You can't. It's like when you receive a gift, it has power. And Indigenous people, we were givers. We gave. And we gave away a lot. And I've been carrying this shirt here, this ribbon shirt, for about 2 years now. I bought it for my trip to BC when I lived here for a year. And you know what? I knew it wasn't for me, and so I'm actually going to give this to Alf. So if you could come up here, Alf. So I bought this in the Taignanega territory, and it's for you. And I don't know if you want to try it on. So Elf and I share this really interesting connection. When I arrived here, you know, I met him and I sang to him. And when I sang to him afterwards, it was as if he had a tear in his eye. I think it's perfect. Right on. All right. Awesome. Cool. Okay. Did you want to say anything? Okay. Okay. And the song that I sang to him actually included his name, Bidabin. And it's the time right before the sun rises. The time when the sun rises is Wabagijigo, right? It's that first light that you see pierce the dawn. But just before that is this really important time. And it's the time when we affirm as peoples the work that we have to do. And we have a lot of work to do. We have to affirm this work, and we have to come together in unity and respect for one another's path in order to achieve this big work that we have to do. And that's what I'm going to talk to you a little bit about today. Before I do, I do want to sing, and usually I'll smudge, but we don't know if, we'll set up. So I'm just going to sing, and very quickly, because I know I can go off track very easily, but very quickly, this is the very first song that came to me. It's a really simple song, and it was right after having sat in ceremony with the elder Sugar Bear, another bear, who was a man who changed my life. And when Sugar Bear handed me tobacco, this song came. And I've received several songs this way now. It's almost like we call it song catching. And there's teachings behind it. And when we really listen deeply within ourselves, our songs will begin to come out. So, way oh hey, oh way oh hey, way hey oh hey oh, way oh hey, oh way oh hey, way hey oh hey oh. So imagine that moment. And so I've carried that song for about 5 years now, and it brings me great joy to share it with you. And it brings me great joy to share with you some of the information that I am going to do today. Like, we're going to talk about the Indigenous model. It's really intense. Some of this stuff, hopefully, you've never seen before, so you can learn something new. Today, we're going to celebrate diversity and how grounding diversity in celebrating and grounding diversity in a celebration of Indigenous knowledge-based framework can have transformative impacts for the inclusion of underrepresented students. Diversity, however, is a complicated word, and I'm going to break it down to the way we're interpreting diversity. I just had this conversation with my friend. He says, well, what does diversity mean to you? Well, in this context, diversity is these three areas. Okay, and I took this off the website for the ASCD, and there's a link to it for you guys. I'm going to share my presentation. But the basic premise of neurodiversity is that there is no typical mental capacity, no normal brain to which all other brains are compared. And because this is the case, we should look at students with autism, ADHD, learning disabilities, intellectual disabilities, emotional and behavior disorders, and other disability categories, not in terms of their deficits, but primarily in terms of their strengths. So how do we do that? How do we transform our environment so it's not a deficit-based model, but a strengths-based model? With respect to the intercultural diversity, in addition to the social, cultural, and environmental differences between groups, there is an enormous diversity of values, lifestyles, and perspectives within a community or urban Aboriginal population. This diversity makes lumping people together under generic terms like Aboriginal and Indigenous profoundly misleading. Nevertheless, most groups share a common social, economic, and political predicament. And that is the legacy of colonization. Okay. And that legacy has impacted us all. Okay. And this is a difficult conversation to have. It's one that we have to have. It's one we have to share. And we have to do it humbly and respectfully. Okay. Because that colonization is the reason why we do what we do. And so how do we start to dismantle colonization to recover from some of the tyranny that it's caused? Okay. And so all around us, the world is changing, and I constantly ask myself, how can I change with the world? And so this is why gender diversity matters.
Аскар таулар мен көл деген таулардың өлкесі. Күзде жаталар алтынмен боялады. Күзде ери бастайды. Бұл әлемдегі ең әсем мекен. Бұл менің халқымның туған жері. Таған ұрпақтан жалғасқан аңшылық және атбегілік салт-дәстүр бар. Бұнда қырандар патшалық құрады. Олардың тек көлеңкелері қане жерге көрінеді. Ата-бабам оларды бафтау құпияларын үйренді. Бірақ менің ата-бабаларым оларды аң алуға қолына қондырған. Бұл ептілік маған мәкеннен жалғасатын болады, дәл ол әкесіне үйренгендей. Thank you. бул жерде менин өмүрүм тамаша. Эки тишем маган өмүр жолун үйрөттү. Ол ұшқанда өзімді еркін сезінем. Мен қазақпын, осы өлкеде туып өстім. Мен бұл таулардың ажырамас бір бөлігімін. Олар да маған солай.
In her region, and this is a trade, a practice that was passed down from generation to generation for men and boys. And Aishulpan came forward and she stepped up to the plate and said, I want to learn, right? And some of the elders, some of the community said, no, that's a man's work. That's a man's position. And she challenged that. And she, at 13 years old, 14 years old, she's actually world famous now. She is the one of the top eagle huntresses in the area. Well, she's the only one, but she's the top eagle hunter. In the region, okay? This is why we have to let down those barriers, right? And recognize that anyone with any background is capable of great feats. So in the celebration of diversity, I want to call on Amy Fell. Is she here? Is Amy here? She's not here? Okay, Amy's not here, but she wanted to share her gifts. Today is all about gift exchange, okay? And to get you guys engaged and continue along, we're gonna ask you a question and you're gonna share amongst the people at your table. But how can your gifts contribute to celebrating diversity at BCIT and beyond? So you're gonna take a few minutes right now and have that conversation at your table.
We're gonna come back together now as a group. Hopefully you took a bit of notes. If you didn't,
I know when we get a chance to talk about these things, it generates a little bit of a buzz, and that's really important. We want to use that energy to continue along. And I want to talk about why using an Indigenous framework for this work is important, okay? And how it can be used. So Waskona Gijigak explains that utilizing Indigenous-based philosophical approaches in research results in methodological and theoretical convergences. I would add here that using an Indigenous knowledge-based framework, based on my experience, it adds a sense of unity and togetherness amongst groups with similar goals but varying agendas. Ray describes the following Ojibwe language phrase. In my home community of Lake Helen Reserve, Red Rock First Nation, the term Gino Amadwad, Migwadu Damwad roughly translates to mean they are learning together while they are doing. It has emerged as a means of thinking about and engaging in research. I have come to understand this term as inclusive and without boundaries. Within this term, concepts such as theory, methodology, ontology, axiology, and method do not exist as singular entities. The concept to learn together while doing as a means to approach and ascertaining new knowledge And in this instance, to celebrate the inclusion of underrepresented groups at the school is supported by well-established Indigenous scholars, including Ray, Simpson, Wilson, Kovach, and Rowe. Okay? And all these references you can have access to. Okay? This approach to knowledge exchange is accented by the community-based participatory research practice. Okay? In this practice, it's just as important how people are engaged as what they're engaged in. And this is why using an Indigenous framework makes sense. But how does it work? Indigenous people look to the natural environment to gain insight into the ways all those natural beings live. Okay? And that informs us. That informs us how to live. And I was just having this conversation before I started about, when is the last time you engaged with the natural environment to literally maybe put your hands in water or put your hands in the snow or put your bare feet on the ground? In today's day, we really can go a whole lifetime without doing this. Okay? And so this disconnection has massive impacts on the way we interpret our life, the way we interpret others, okay? The way we engage with others. So why is this important? Why is the connection to the environment important? Well, we're in a time like no other in history. The Center for Biodiversity claims that human activity is responsible for the current mass extinction event. Okay? This will result in at least 30 to 50% of all species, plants, and animals disappearing by mid-century. Moreover, with the rise of loss of speciation, the 2016 Living Planet Report estimates that 2/3 of all plant and animal populations will vanish by 2020. Humans are merely a reflection of their natural environment. If we can celebrate and honor what is within, okay, we will be able to honor what is outside and perhaps prevent the catastrophe that is, it's here. It's here and now, and we see that with what happened in the last 5 days here in Vancouver. So this time for action, the time to celebrate diversity is now. For Indigenous people, cyclical themes of growth, renewal, and transformation were derived through a participatory process. An observation of the natural cycles that occurred within the seasons, animal migrations, life cycles of the human, plant, and animal worlds, and lunar cycles. And so I'm going to talk about those with you today. I'm going to talk about how we start by honoring the four directions, and that's something that Elf did at the very beginning. Okay. But there's also the above, and the below, and the center. So as humans, we're always orientated to seven directions, okay, with our heart being at the center. And this is why I'm calling on people to use their gifts. What is in your heart? Are you looking to that place so that you can reflect outwards what it is that your heart is telling you? From that, I think I skipped one. No, we're good. From the seven directions, we move on towards the four major aspects of holistic well-being: mind, body, spirit, and emotions. Are you honoring your emotions? I found having spent 12 years, having spent 12 years now in university, which may come as a shock. Like, yeah, it's crazy. I hope to be done like in the next 6 months. Anyways, having seen that environment, grown up in it, right? I've almost spent more time there than anywhere else in my life. I've noticed that emotions are often put to the side. And this increases stress levels. It increases people's anxieties, right? And also that spirit part. How do you honor those things? How do you enable people to recognize the value of those parts of themselves? In correspondence with these four parts of holistic well-being, we have these seven principles of love, respect, honesty, humility, bravery, wisdom, and truth. Now, these are the grounding principles that guided Anishinaabe, right? My ancestors. They're going to look a little different here. They're going to look, they're going to be a reflection of the people here. And from what I've seen and learned, having spent a year in BC, having spoken to some knowledge stewards, I've seen that the very similar principles are honored in this place. Okay, I'm not sure why that's doing that. Okay. So, okay, I want to go back. Okay. So the next piece, okay, sorry buddy, just one sec. Okay, is these four aspects of consciousness development. Okay, we have childhood, we begin in the East with childhood. We move on to adolescence, adulthood, and elder. Now what we have to recognize is that these are not about how old you are. For indigenous people, these are about how you've committed yourself to the teachings of the land, the teachings of the ancestors, following that path. Okay. So at this point, I'm going to ask Buddy if you could share for us a little bit about your gift and just right where you are. This is part of the day today, is there's going to be several people who are going to share some of their gifts. So, Buddy, please.
Dansi, Neo Weanigani Daksigikspa. It's hello. My ancestral name is He Who Comes First in the Morning. My English name, Buddy Cardinal. So anyway, I work with Access Trades. I'll keep this short. My gift, I worked like as a tradesman for years, as a carpenter. So I was in a ceremony some time ago. The roadman, like he said, you're gonna help a lot of people. Okay. So, you know, working as a carpenter, and it was always in my nature to help people. But shortly after that, I finished a project, the Evergreen Line. So I was, you know, inquiring to Access, because I went through Access to get my Red Seal years ago. I was just inquiring about different opportunities to come up. And he's like, well, actually, there's an opportunity coming up to be a training and employment coach. Would you be interested? And growing up in Vancouver, urban, I said, yeah, you know, for sure. Like, I think I can relate to these young people. You know, it's been good. You know, I feel good about what I do. I'm helping the people, it's ongoing. So that's my gift is to help people. Mm-hmm. Oh,
thank you. Okay. So last time I was here, I asked the group. What is your gift? And you know, no one put up their hand. No one was willing at that time to share what their gift was. But today, we're seeing people coming forward and saying, I'm willing to share my gift. And this is critical because these are people who are using what it is that comes from their heart to apply to their everyday. Thank you, Bodhi, for doing that. That's huge. I want to keep talking, but okay. So, one of the most critical stages, and I can just go back here, is this part here: spring, summer, fall, and winter. These are times of solstices and equinoxes. There are times when the earth literally shifts. Okay? There are times that our ancestors celebrated, wherever your ancestors come from, because these are times that were celebrated all around the world, and great temples have been built. All across the earth to celebrate these times. And I've been so fortunate to visit some of these temples and learn from some of the people who still honor these times. This celebrating the solstice and the equinox becomes essential to implementing the indigenous model. And hopefully during these, the next one we have upcoming is spring. Hopefully we get to see you guys come back. And for some of you to share at that event, at the celebration of the spring equinox. So that we can honor, what are we honoring when we honor the spring? Yeah, we're honoring that abundance that Mother Earth gives to us. So I'm going to fire through a couple more of these, but the next cycle that we honored is the moon cycle. Okay. This is the one that cleanses the waters, right? This is our grandmother, and she's done extraordinary work. The other thing we honor in the indigenous framework is celebrating each and every culture and the teachings that they carry, the beliefs that they have. Right? And when I celebrate the uniqueness of the gifts of my neighbors, I start recognizing their strengths can enhance the community that I'm a part of. Imagine you walk through the halls and everybody knew what your gift was, and they celebrated you. Right? Now, that's a bit of wishful thinking. I think we're a long ways from that point. Okay? But if we can start to establish a community, people who come together around these important moments in time, right, throughout the year, we're going to see extraordinary changes take place. And I've seen it happen. I'm going to talk about it a little bit later, okay? The last piece here is just about land sustainability. This is incorporated into the model. Okay, the environment plays an integral role. This is more towards some of the research that I'm doing right now. But once we go through these seven steps, we return to the beginning, okay? And we start again. And when we've committed to this work, when we've recognized the value of it, okay, we start to build. Okay? And each year, the celebration becomes greater. Each year, more people are invited. Every year, every time we celebrate, new people get to come forward to share their gifts. Okay, so this is exciting. Is Kathy here? Okay.
Hi, I'm Kathy. I'm Kathy from the Learning Commons. One of the great gifts I've received in life was my opportunity to study my master's in adult education at UBC, and it really was the best educational experience of my life, and I developed a lot. I think I went through quite a transformative experience, and I had been teaching for many years, and I was able to develop at that time a framework of understanding, my way of teaching that was based on theory, educational theory, and research. So it was really exciting. And two things that I came out with were, I mean, the core of my way of teaching is to base any learning and teaching on authentic dialogue. And another thing that I came out with was a sense of agency, that when we learn, we are actually going to do something with what we learn rather than just, what I think of as book learning. I learn it, and I think I was like that to a certain extent before, to quite an extent maybe. So I came out, and it was after that we started the Learning Commons here at BCIT, and I share what I gained from that experience with our peer tutors, and I think our tutors are a gift to all of us because they're just wonderful students, but through the training that they receive, they go out and they do a spectacular job, and they tutor, but they are also mentors to all the students that they work with, and they end up being like mentors to each other, and we have a real learning community there in the Learning Commons whenever they are working. So.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's so great to see people sharing. And I know how hard it can be sometimes to share amongst our own peers, right? But to stand in our power and say, this is my gift, this is what I have to share, this is the great work that I've been doing. And from what I've seen, I think it needs to be done more, not just in published things that you read, but in conversation and in looking people in the eye and say, this is the great work that I've done, right? And it doesn't just have to be in this environment. It can be anywhere. And I know some of you, who plants a garden? Okay, we have one gardener. Oh, two, okay, three, a four. Thank you. Thank you for planting a garden. That's my real passion. But I'm going to continue along, and we're going to get a second activity going here. What are the ways that you can utilize an Indigenous framework here in your work at BCIT? So I want you, again, have that discussion. Maybe take some notes that we can use after, some feedback. So we'll take another maybe 3 or 4 minutes amongst the people in your table. Go ahead.
So I'm going to continue on here. Thanks. And
I have like quite a bit more to talk about and share, so I'm going to try and fire through it. But thank you guys for talking about that and engaging in that discussion. And one of our teachings is that around this time, I was sharing this with our table, with the full moon, that draws some of our toxins to the surface of our skin. And so this is the time when men traditionally would go sweat, is at the time of the full moon, so that we could sweat out those toxins and be prepared for the next 29 days. And so if I think about that in like the sense of here we are, we're all a little bit toxic right now. And you know, normally around this time, we would go into sweat and we would release those toxins. So something to think about. So with this grant, we continue to be inclusive, and we're generating feedback on how best to approach the program using the gifts already present here. So we're calling on you guys, we're calling on the people who are part of this community to say, this is my gift, and this is how I can share, to celebrate diversity, to celebrate those groups that are underrepresented, who in some instances are in unsafe situations. So as the model begins to activate, there's still much work to do. And those staff, those people who are here are interested in the gift exchange, right? This is what I interpret as mentoring. I did mentoring work for a long time. But really what I saw was it's people coming forward and saying, here's my gift, and I want to share it with you. And people say, wow, look at that person. They're sharing their gift. I want to do that. Okay? In an Indigenous model, it's about modeling the behavior that you want to see rather than creating parameters around the things you don't want to see, which is often what we see in institutions. Okay? And so all these people are involved in this work. You are involved in this work. Okay? We're at this stage where we're generating a sense of family. And we're going to reach out to the students with the gifts that are present amongst the staff and the community here and say, hey, welcome. Here's the gifts we're going to share with you. Here's the strengths that we have. What are yours? Okay. And I don't know how that's going to look. I can't say, I know how it's looked in the past when I've applied this in my own work, but I can't tell you how it's going to look here. Okay. The next stage would be figuring out who is the community of stakeholders, who are the people that surround this environment, this college, who contribute to this college, who also have gifts, who also have something to share. How can they be part of the celebration? This one is probably a few years away, and it probably won't be included in terms of this funding, right? But hopefully people buy into this, right? And how many other programs can we maybe, I know there's attrition in like financial, financial parameters, right? I don't like financial parameters, but I understand that that those exist and those are real, and we have to exist within it. So who can we lobby within the school to say, can you contribute to this ongoing? Because there has to be a commitment for it to succeed. Eventually, you know, in my dream world, BCIT becomes this lush food forest where I can walk outside and pick berries when I'm hungry, or I can eat off the trees. Now, that's maybe a little bit of wishful thinking, but that is literally how we lived. Okay? So maybe wishful thinking in terms of the infrastructure we built today. But this is how indigenous people lived. We had complex societies, right? Millions upon millions of people, and we could literally walk out, take a fruit off the tree and eat it, right? Or go to our storage and eat dried berries, dried fruit. And it was always fresh. It was always organic, okay? So to think that it's not possible is that's the dream. That's the you have to let go, because we've had it. We had it here, and it was beautiful, and it was incredible. And this is what I study and activate, right, in my own work. Okay. So this commitment, right? Aboriginal people, the population is growing 6 times the rate of the non-Aboriginal population according to the 2011 census. 1.4 million people currently, and that's roughly only 4% of Canada's population. Okay. Of these, 48% are under the age of 24. Okay. Given these estimates, okay, in the next 15 years alone, over 300,000 Aboriginal youth could enter the workforce. Okay. If ever there were a time, okay, to be inclusive, that time is now. If ever there were a time to utilize the strengths of Indigenous knowledge, that time is now. Okay. For those who are in administration, for those who work with budgets, okay, if we close the educational gap with our Aboriginal youth, okay, and it's not just youth. Okay, I work with adult students who have come back and who are trying their best to learn, get an education. In terms of gross domestic product, we could potentially add $179 billion in growth, okay, over the next 20 years, and $400 billion in total growth, okay, to our gross domestic product. Okay. These numbers suggest that better understanding Indigenous peoples and how we live and who we are, this is a critical time, right? And so great to be a part of this project. In my previous work, some of the things that came out, right, of grounding this work, right, because I had sort of this unique story that while working on my doctoral comprehensive exams, which for some people is like, that's what they do, right? It's a big task. Who's done it? Okay, a few people here. Super intense, okay? Not only was I doing my comprehensive exams, okay, but I was directly applying the Indigenous knowledge that I was learning by lobbying the university that I was at to establish an Indigenous food and medicine garden, which was built. Okay, at the time, I was also co-founding the teaching of the first in the city comprehensive community-based Indigenous studies program. In fact, the only other places at the time that were doing that work were here in BC, some of the colleges here. Over 200 individuals made contributions of their gifts, of sharing their strengths to make that happen. Okay? And there's other stuff too. All the while, everything that I was doing, I always celebrated. Okay? People say, oh, how was Christmas? And I say, Christmas? What's that? Right? I haven't celebrated Christmas for about 8 years. Okay? But I have celebrated the winter solstice. And this year, celebrating this winter solstice, I was on Tikal, right? Praying for humanity that we would wake up. Okay. And so we have Ty, and he's going to share, and he has a little video that he wants to share. So I'm going to play it for you. But Ty, do you want to share before I cue it up?
Sure. Hi. Hey, guys. I'm Ty Embry. I'm from Rec Services. So I run the fitness center I just want to share with you guys is our mission on diversity. So the mission that we came up with is, if you're not including everybody, you're excluding somebody, right? So every time we try to do something, we think about that mission. How can I include the entire BCIT community? People say, oh, you know, you're just a gym. Well, yeah, but we also have a really high set of standards. We want to make sure people feel included. My background, I'm Australian, so it doesn't sound like it. If I have a few drinks, then I sound Australian. some of my gifts, so Australian outlooks, we like to keep things simple and direct, right? Also, to me, small steps are just as important as big steps. So I like low-hanging fruit, right? So what else are Australians about? We're proud. We're blunt. We like to step up and say yes. That's not my first inkling. I'm actually shy, quiet, not so colorful. But I force myself to step up and talk into the this, even though I don't like it. So I step outside my comfort zone to be an example. I like when people speak and contribute. Nothing sucks when someone says, what's your favorite color? And no one answers. It's awkward, right? So that's a little bit about me. Rec Services has a goal to work with every single person at BCIT collaboratively. So we actually have a whiteboard, and we've listed all the schools, all the different services that we provide, and when we feel we've worked collaboratively, we go through and check it, because some of us feel that BCIT is a little, your department does this, your department does this. We're supposed to be a community, right? So if we all take that mission to work collaboratively, you know, it works a little bit better. So this is a video that Mark Holm put together for us. It kind of showcases a little bit of the diversity and goals that the Fitness Center has. So.
The fitness center was recently renovated, and we're so excited about the new services and benefits available for BCIT students and staff. BCIT's Rec Center promotes cultural diversity, and we want our international students to feel at home in the gym. With new technology like the international icon, gym users can choose one of the 16 different languages with a click of a button.
The Fitness Center has also been updated with a brand new layout, including six new sections. The powerlifting area, functional training, cardio, the circuit training pods, cable systems, and free weights.
BCIT is inclusive to everyone, so they made it so easy for anyone to access every area of the gym, including widened lanes, adjustable cables with different length handles, and the awesome staff are always on hand to assist anyone who needs help.
We're proud that our new fitness center promotes diversity, accessibility, and is inclusive to everyone. Come check out the changes and see for yourself.
Thank you. Oops, I better stop the videos. Okay, thank you, Ty. That's great. Great addition to the day. So I know that I'm running out of time, and hopefully you guys don't have to run out of here right away. I may only go couple minutes over, but there are a couple more things that are really critical to the day. Okay, this is part of the original plan. Okay, I developed a mind map and just something that I did to contribute using my gifts. Okay, but today is about mentoring, and I know you're probably thinking, well, we're trying to show you. I'm trying to show, to lead by example, how it is we get others to do. To draw out their gift and show their strengths, okay? We're trying to build relationships. And when we build relationships, okay, I'm going to go off this because it's throwing me off. Okay. We have to look into people's eyes and say, thank you for coming, okay? So that I can see you smile, right? And connecting with our peers. Look around you, These are the people who are part of your community. Now I'm coming in here as a guest, and I hope I get to come back and to share again. Right? But when I look around, I see people. It's Friday, so I see people ready to probably hit the road a little bit. But I also see people who are really passionate about working together, working with the people who are in this community to say, hey, we can make a difference. I can make a difference. And if it's just, somebody was saying just the other day, you can make a difference in just one life. And you've made a difference. And some people's work will be making a difference in a lot of people's lives. What if it's just making a difference in your own life? By going to your heart, finding what it is your gift is, and in using that gift to do the work here at the college. How many people here can say, I'm doing exactly what I want to do here, and I love it? See, that's huge, okay? That's huge. Now, the people, if you can't say that yet, go find out from the person who just put up their hand and say, how'd you do that? How are you doing that, right? When we get a chance to work in environments that we love and that we cherish and that we honor, all of a sudden, huge changes start to take place. Because I'm reflecting outwards what I want to see. And all of a sudden, I meet these extraordinary people like I met over the last few days just being here. And it's like, thank you guys all for contributing. I don't know what your mentoring model is going to look like. But I know one of our teachings is that when we harvest. When we harvest as Anishinaabe people, we give that first harvest away. And we give it to the person in most need. So when you look around in your community, can you recognize where that need is? And can you use the harvest, right? Whether it be your work here, whether it be your work outside of here, can you use the harvest to share with the people in most need? And so our last contributor is Bavina. Is that, did I say it right? Okay, perfect. Thank you. Please.
Hi, I'm Bavina. I'm with the Program Advising Office. I was asked to share with everyone here my gift, and when I got the email, I said, sure, and then I thought, uh-oh, I don't know what my gift is. And so in program advising, I've got Suki here, and she's across the office from me, and I had this discussion with her, and I said, I have no idea what my gift is. I've been asked to speak, and I don't know what to say. And she says, it's the ability to share knowledge and personal stories of challenges and success to spark a connection with people. And I went home and I had this discussion with my husband, and I didn't tell him what Suki had said. And he kind of said the same thing. And I was like, well, I had to ask myself, like, what makes me want to share? Why do I share? Why do I share my experiences? And so it made me think back to the different generations. So I think it's a gift of sharing that's been handed down from generations. So for example, when my grandfather immigrated from Fiji to Vancouver, he came on his own. He had, I think, a handful of friends, two or three friends that came along with him, but they all had to work with each other and they all had to settle down together, and then they invited the families over. But then they also helped other families settle, so they gave them food, they gave them shelter. And then it was my father's turn. So growing up, we had a lot of family and people that we didn't even know stay with us. And there were times where I used to think, God, you know, I just want to sleep in my room. I want to have my bed. But it was always, nope, we have to help these people. They're here. They're only here for a short time. We have a few businesses. And so I remember walking in one day to my father's business, and there was this new man sitting, and it sewing business, so we used to stitch clothes. And we had a staff, and I remember he, really old guy, and I couldn't figure out why my dad had hired him, because he was old and he was really slow. So he's holding up the production, right? And I went home and I said to my mom, like, why would dad do this? And she says to me, there must have been some connection between, and my dad doesn't know this old, poor old man, and he came in and he shared his story about how he had come from India, and he was sponsored by his son, but his son threw him out, threw his wife and him out, and he basically had to try to earn a living, and he must have been in his like mid-60s, late-60s maybe. And so my dad hired him on, and I didn't question my father after that, but okay, fine, so we move on. And then my mom, she goes shopping to Fruitacana on Fraser and 41st area, and she's shopping with my sister-in-law for groceries, and there's this young woman who asks them a question about something, and they somehow get connected, and they start sharing stories of, I guess, where she's from and whatnot. And so it turned out that her husband was on a study permit, and she had just moved. She's really young, maybe, I think, 20, 21. And my mom invites her over for tea, brings her home, and then takes her shopping to Costco. So when I was growing up, they used to send money overseas to family to help support them. And I used to always say, you know, that's fine that you do that, but what about us? So I think it was a bit of culture clash, because I used to always want to wear the trendiest clothes, and but here they were sending money overseas, so we were wearing hand-me-downs. And they all shared with each other, they all shared with people that they didn't even know, without the expectation that they were going to get something back in return. So fast forward to the present, and I must have subconsciously adopted this gift of sharing, because I've seen this gift of sharing in my boys. And so my oldest son, who was 5 at the time, he'd lost his tooth, and so the tooth fairy had to come and give him something under his pillow. And the tooth fairy didn't have change that evening, so he got up the next morning and he got a 20. So I said to him, so his name's Shiv, I said, Shiv, so what are you going to do with this? Like, what are we going to buy? What do you want to do? And he says, well, we need to go and buy stuff for people that don't have anything. And I said, well, don't you want to, that's fine, but don't you want to get something for yourself too? He says, no, we'll just go and we'll buy something for people that don't have anything. So we went to Superstore and we bought some baby food, you know, helped him count how much he was spending, and we donated it to the food bank. My three-year-old, just a few weeks back, my parents look after my kids during the day while I'm at work, and so I had their lunches and everything packed for the day, and we were at a light, and in the morning, usually you don't see the homeless people around at the intersection, so this particular morning, there was a man standing there, and my younger son, Dev, he was really, really upset. And he says, Mama, that man, he's going to starve to death. We have to give him some food. And I didn't know what to give him. I didn't have anything. So he pulled out his lunch bag, and he took out his sliced apples that I had packed for his lunch. And he insisted that I roll down my window and give him the apples that we had. So I did that. And I even said to him, I said, Dev, well, what about your lunch? He's like, but he's going to starve to death. He wasn't thinking about himself. He was thinking about what's going to happen to this other man. So really, I think if we don't share our strengths and we don't share our challenges and we don't look after ourselves as a human species, when you look at the bigger picture of things, we're going to die. We're not going to be around. So my gift, I think, whether it's to the community here or to mankind in general, is the gift of sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing. I know people have to go. I'm going to, there's two more slides. This last one was the last activity. We're going to skip over it. But maybe before you leave, just write down one stakeholder that you can think of that could contribute to this work, that is a stakeholder of BCIT, a community member, somebody who you think could make a contribution to the celebration of diversity. And last but not least, when we do this work, it really is like the rippling out of waves from a pond when a stone's thrown in. Okay, and when I start to recognize and see your gifts, right, and you start to recognize and see your own and others, right, this has literally, and I've seen it, transformative power. Because I'm not looking at the things that you don't know and the things that you didn't do and the things that you're incapable of. I'm looking at all the things that you are capable of. Are we able as a group, as a community in here right now, when we go out and enjoy our weekend, I'm going to Whistler, so hopefully it's not raining. But can we look out and can we recognize the gifts in each and every person that we encounter and honor them? It's not easy. It's not going to be easy, okay? But I know that you can do it. And I can't wait to see how this develops over time. So thank you so much. Thank you to the organizers, the people who are doing the real work. And yeah, thank you. Thanks. Yeah. And yeah, you good? Cool.
Before you guys head out, we'll actually want to give a quick song back to Andrew.
Oh, yeah.
Because it was his birthday on Tuesday. So let's do the happy birthday song to end. So thanks for online for joining, but let's give it to him.
Right. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming tonight.